Hi, everybody. Welcome.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to Meals on Wheels, America.org, sponsored this particular exposure by Grace and Frankie.
That's right.
We're going to do a table read of one of our episodes for the seventh season.
That's right. We've actually filmed this back in at the end of January. But
we don't say F. They'll never understand why we are so inept at reading it. We've already filmed it.
Hey, Lily, how have you been doing with the show at home?
I've been learning to cook. I found out how many tablespoons of anything are in a quarter cup of sour cream.
Oh, you've been cooking. Oh, my God.
I found a good dish. I do rice cauliflower with a ton of mushrooms.
Right? It's good, isn't it?
Has Stephen already done that for you?
Well, he's homesick, and I'm quarantined.
What kind of sick?
Not COVID sick.
Okay. Well, that's a blessing.
Yeah, but I've had friends. What a terrible. We hope that all of you watching are safe and that you stay safe. And our hearts go out to the suffering that's happening because of this.
And you've got a mask. And you've got rubber gloves and everything else that's needed. Please promise us you'll do that.
Yeah. Yeah. But if you get hungry, we're supporting Meals on Wheels.
Meals on Wheels, America.org.
Grace and Frankie, this is providing meals and support for people that are homebound. It's a fantastic organization.
You know, it's Meals on Wheels. Hey, hi, Sam.
How are you doing? We're all here for the same thing, Meals on Wheels, America.org. Brought to you by Grace and Frankie. That's us. Hi.
Hi. We're doing good.
We've got Nancy Stein over there. That's Martin Sheen.
Yeah. Hello, Martin.
Martin.
Hello, all.
Wait, Martin Stein is suspiciously written by the same person as yours, Jane.
Yeah. So, have you two been seeing each other? Because you know you're supposed to be isolating.
I want to just tell the people this is an amazing historic event because Martin Sheen doesn't own a computer. He doesn't know how to do anything on social media. So having him part of this is really an extraordinary miracle. I applaud you, Martin.
Thank you. That miracle is seated next to me here, my daughter, Renee.
Martin Sheen doesn't even have a cell phone.
I have it. I just don't know how to answer it.
But he has known for a long time how to sit in front of a camera.
Hey, it's Meals on Wheels, America.org/Grace and Frankie.
Oh, they didn't tell me slash.
I didn't know about slash either.
Oh, put the slash in.
I didn't even know about slash.
Oh, there's two.
I believe.
Diane and Raphael.
It's so happy to be here.
So
great. Hey, everyone.
And everybody should know that the woman who came in between there with the glasses, she is Marta Kaufman, who was our showrunner. She kind of created the idea for the whole thing.
Yes, and with Howard Morris, who's right there.
The other show.
Howard Morris, the co-creator of that great esteemed series, Grace and Frankie.
My favorite show.
Bravo, bravo.
And mostly headlined by the ravishing June Diane Raphael.
Hey.
Hey. Brooklyn's here.
Hello. Brooklyn is here. Baron is here.
Yeah.
Ethan.
Baron is in Atlanta.
No, Ethan's in Atlanta.
Is your second child born, Ethan?
Ethan's
in Atlanta. I can't remember.
Baron's second child is born, and I'm in Atlanta.
You're in Atlanta.
We're interchangeable. We are one and the same. Bud and Coyote, we're just like this melded character sandwich.
A mess.
Where are you, Brooklyn?
I am in North Carolina.
Oh, wow. Right,
really? Now.
Yes.
And there's Michael.
Sam, hi.
Guys.
Hi, Michael.
Good to see everybody.
Michael Rowan, who plays Adam, and Cora Vanderbrook, who plays Agent Karen Fenmore.
Yes.
That tells you something about the seventh season. This is agent, FBI agent.
And by the way, for you audience, you should know that all of these people came and were part of Fire Drill Friday in DC, and they all engaged in civil disobedience and got arrested. They're all wonderful.
True that.
We did. You want to get started?
Are we all here?
So let's get started. Let me just say a couple things before we jump in. Following the table read, we're going to be doing a Q&A. So please leave your questions in the comment section where you're watching.
And that's when the fun will start.
That is when the fun will start. Just to remind everybody, tonight's table read is going to benefit Meals on Wheels.
.org.
Their COVID-19 response. And we know that the virus poses its greatest threat to American seniors. And Meals on Wheels is on the front lines, keeping older Americans safe and nourished.
And those so are your time, two stars.
MealsOnWheelsAmerica.org/Grace and Frankie. So just before we start, I just want to say what a table read is. Obviously, a table read is because we sit around a table and we read the script. But the purpose of a table read is that that is the first time the writers get to hear the words they've written out loud. It's an incredibly crucial tool for us because this is our chance to make sure the dialogue and the story are right before we shoot it. So before we start our table read, we always introduce our cast. And let's start with Jane Fonda playing Grace Hansen. Lily Tomlin is our Frankie Bergstein. Martin Sheen is our Robert Hansen. Sam Waterston is Saul Bergstein.
Yeah.
Jean Diane Raphael is our Brianna
Hansen.
Brooklyn Decker is Mallory.
Yeah.
Mallory, yay! Dominated.
Ethan Embry is our Coyote. And Baron Vaughn is Bud.
Yeah.
So, Howard.
Yes.
By the way, I'm going to read stage directions so that you understand what the action is as we go through it.
And I will just get us up to date because this is our first episode of season 7, which, as Jane said, has been filmed, but will be when we actually see the whole season. So at the end of season 6, if you remember, right, some big stuff happened, okay? Grace's husband, Nick, was arrested for evading taxes, which was shocking, but he did brag about it a lot. And Grace and Frankie then discovered that he left them several hundred thousand dollars in cash in the couch that Grace hated. Which they plan to now use to fund the Rise Up. And everybody remembers that's their rising toilet that they took on Shark Tank. So Grace moves back in with Frankie, only to find that Robert and Saul are also moving in with them because of that same toilet. Because Frankie gave the guys a Rise Up as a gift, and it ended up exploding and flooding their house and caused so much damage that they had to move out. So no one is too happy about this new living situation, including Bud and Coyote, who are bearing the brunt of their parents' dysfunction. And Brianna is unhappy because she's Brianna. But also because Mallory has now become her boss. So we hope you enjoy this reading and it just takes your mind off your troubles for a few minutes. And it is the first episode of season 7. And I just hope that it goes a little smoother than my family's Zoom Passover Seder last night. but if it's anything like rehearsal, it won't. with that, should we get started?
Let's get started. This is Grace and Frankie, episode 701. Exterior, beach house, dunes, beach patio. In a long shot, we see the ocean at the Adirondack chairs
and two people holding hands as they gaze out to the sea. We pull back to reveal our heroines, Grace and Frankie, standing on the beach patio, 10 minutes after season 6, glaring at the imposters, Robert and Saul, who sit in their chairs.
Roomies! Roomies!
Yeah, I would think we owe them because our toilet blew up in their house.
We should probably find out why that happened, right?
Yeah, unless we want all our customers to live with us. But, you know, it still doesn't give them the right to use our house as a beach house.
Right. But they'll come to their senses after a week of overpriced pancakes.
You need to get them out of here before they change into soft pants. Once those things are cinched up, it's...
Let's sit. Am I on?
Let's
send them to a real hotel.
With what? My credit cards don't work. Yours never work. It's not like we can use the money in the freezer. We got to get that money out of the freezer.
Grace rushes into the house. We're interior the beach house living room. Grace enters and bolts towards the kitchen, trailed by Frankie.
Why would they think the money is in our freezer?
Because you told them to. And if they find it, they're going to get into our business and say we can't spend it. Or worse, they'll want it for their new floors.
Oh, as if they need floors. What are they, feet?
We head into the kitchen. We're exterior beach house dunes. Robert and Saul are as we left them on the Adirondack chairs.
Could be worse, Saul.
Billy, because right now I'm wishing we took the cruise where everyone got botulism.
I'm just saying that I'm okay with all of this because I'm here with you. Maybe it's a chance for us to connect. It's been a while.
Are you really bringing this up now? Our floors are waterlogged. We may be facing mold, for God's sake.
But we're in a romantic place.
There is no chance for romance in our ex-wife's house.
Saul gets up abruptly and starts towards the house.
Didn't stop us before.
Interior beach house kitchen. The freezer now open. Frankie pulls out a Mrs. Paul's frozen fish sticks box, reaches in and starts handing packets of cash to Grace.
I know we're kind of in a rush, but quick feelings check-in.
Right now I'm feeling irritated by your feelings check-in.
What about Nick?
I'm mortified. I went from being a woman who didn't know her husband was gay to a woman who didn't know her husband was a criminal. I'm not sure it's an upgrade.
Next time, just marry a gay criminal and check off all the boxes.
Frankie hands the last of the money to Grace.
What's going on in your box? Where's the rest of the money?
Geez, Grace, you never hide all the loot in one spot. I hid it in 4 places, and I have a simple system to remember where they are. Each stash is named after the beetle most associated with his hiding place. Paul, Mrs. Paul's fish sticks, genius.
And how stoned were you when you came up with this system?
I thought my hand was see-through. Frankie?
Saul's inside the house.
She's not here.
Grace and Frankie look at each other. Where the hell are they going to hide the money? Interior beach house dining room kitchen. Saul passes the stairs and enters the kitchen to see Grace trying to look casual, and Frankie turned away from him, closing the freezer.
What do you want now, Saul?
And pancakes are $4.
Frankie turns around, and we see they've clearly stuffed the money into her bra. Saul stares at her lumpy chest.
Eyes up here, pal.
Just as Robert enters, the Ring doorbell buzzes. Grace answers.
Hello?
This is Agent Karen Fenmore with the FBI again. Mrs. Skolka, we'd like to talk to you.
Grace buzzes them in.
Why in God's name would the FBI want to talk to you?
Okay, roomies, quick update. Nick got arrested and is in jail. Grace got humiliated and is back here. And how do you feel about Ty tonight?
What? We just had Ty. Wait, what's this about Nick?
We're interior, say Grace, Brianna's office. Mallory is standing in front of Brianna's desk, screwing up her courage. She takes a deep breath and begins to speak.
Brianna,
I understand how me being your supervisor is going to be weird, to say the least. I mean, not as weird as that time I saw you tanning your butthole, but it's still weird. Obviously, I'll be going back and forth to headquarters in San Francisco, but when I'm here, I'm going to need a real desk. We'll have to share Adam. And most importantly, I want the respect that my new position calls for. Am I making myself clear?
Cut to Brianna's empty chair. Mallory has been talking to no one. She's merely been practicing her speech. Brianna enters, swooping in a la Devil Wears Prada, throwing her coat and bags on the conference table.
Oh, you're still here. Did you at least bring me a muffin?
I am not your muffin girl, Brianna. I'm your supervisor. But yes, I brought you a muffin.
Brianna sits at the chair behind her desk. She realizes that Mallory is still standing in front of her.
Something you wanted to say to me? I have work to do.
Brianna indicates the conference table. Mallory, disappointed in herself, hangs her head and goes to the kitty table. Adam enters holding papers and sees that each woman is sitting in her usual place.
Good morning, and for our first day in upside down world, things look remarkably the same.
I'm assuming you have a purpose?
Two, bringing back bow ties, and getting these papers signed.
Brianna sticks her hand out to receive them.
By Mallory.
Brianna's not happy.
I get to sign something? Fun. Could you bring them over here, please?
Feeling caught, Adam glances at Brianna to get a read as to whether he should.
See what happens. Do you feel lucky?
No.
Office impasse. Interior, beach house, family room. A protective Frankie sits next to a nervous Grace who is being questioned by FBI agents Karen Fenmore and Ron Siskin, a chiseled, silent, humorless giant. Not that Karen is a barrel of laughs. Robert and Saul are standing by the kitchen and looking on with concern.
This isn't my first rodeo. I'll do the talking.
Though we want to talk to Grace.
Oh, that won't stop her.
Mrs. Skolko, we came back to seize the rest of Nick's assets and found that the living room couch had been ripped up. And that confused us because sometimes things are hidden in couches.
You mean like candies and such?
I was thinking more like cash.
Angle on an alarmed Robert, who turns to Saul and whispers,
"Didn't Frankie mention something about money in the freezer?"
Saul subtly drifts backwards to the refrigerator.
"Do you know anything about the couch, Mrs. Skolka?"
I know I really hated it. And you can imagine how I felt about Nick at the moment.
So you took out your anger at your husband on your couch?
No, I took out her anger at her husband on her couch.
It sure feels like your first rodeo.
I was doing her emotional work. And oh my God, I slipped past the page.
Yeah.
I was doing her emotional work. And yes, it's a way of subtly robbing her of her feelings, and that's on me. I mean, I think we're done here, Karen. Nice to meet you, Mount Rushmore.
Angelon saw closing the freezer. He shakes his head at Robert reassuringly, indicating there's no money in there.
My problem here is that the two of you were the only ones in that apartment.
Okay, Karen, I know where you're going. I'm already there and I'm on my way back. You see what I'm saying?
No one sees what you're saying.
I'm saying we've got nothing to hide.
So you won't mind if Rushmore and I take a look around?
Actually, I mind. There's a little thing I call civil liberties.
Everyone calls it that.
And what it means is that you don't treat the wife of the alleged criminal as if she too is a criminal.
I'm sorry, who are you?
I'm her ex-husband. And yes, Grace can be harsh and often vindictive. Lord knows she's had some low moments. Mostly due to drink.
Is this going to turn around sometime soon, Robert?
But she's a woman of principle and would never lie to law enforcement.
And my ex-wife is also a woman of principle. I mean, she might lie to law enforcement, but only for a very good reason.
Neither of these guys is speaking at our funeral.
Look, Karen, I'm a lawyer, and I've got you on unlawful search, witness harassment, and I'm just getting started. So you might as well leave right now, because you're not turning over one cushion in this house today, next week, or ever.
We'll get a search warrant.
Okay, then we'll see you tomorrow. How's 10? Rushmore, you're up early, right?
Perhaps we should see the nice agents out.
Robert pulls Saul and they walk the agents out as they exit.
Actually, I like to sleep in.
Once Grace and Frankie are alone.
Well, that was too close for comfort.
Hey, at least we got them off our trail.
They're coming back tomorrow.
Frank takes the money out from her bra and hands it to Grace.
I'll handle the money from now on. Let's just get it all into a safe place and then get it out of here.
What place is safe with these two bozos around?
The safe. My bedroom that they don't know the combination to. Gosh.
I'll get the rest of the dough.
No.
Two steps, then stops abruptly and turns around to Grace with a panic-stricken look.
Oh my God, no. You have a simple system to remember where they are.
Grace, I don't want to kick you when you're down, but you probably shouldn't have put me in charge of that.
We are interior beach house kitchen later. The kitchen cabinets are all flung open and Grace has pulled out all of Frankie's cereal boxes and is rifling through them by hand, not caring about spillage. She suddenly feels the money in the cornflakes box. She does not see Robert enter.
Didn't you used to yell at the kids for scrounging through the cereal to get the prize?
Prizes have gotten better.
Grace, I'm really sorry to hear about Nick.
I'm really sorry you heard about it too. Can we not talk about this?
Hey, if you need someone to not talk to, I'm your man. I just, you know, you deserve better husbands than you've had.
Thank you.
He notices her hand has not left the inside of the cereal box.
Are you going to take your hand out of the cornflakes?
No.
All right. We don't have to talk about that either.
He heads to the refrigerator and starts taking out containers of leftovers.
Yeah, well, wait, what are you doing?
I've been ravenous lately and I don't know why. Oh yes, we have all the fixings for a spaghetti and meatball sandwich.
No, you're gonna ruin your appetite for dinner.
Trust me, I'll rally.
We are interior beach house meditation room. Frankie is looking through all of her spiritual paraphernalia.
My sweet Lord, George has to be in here somewhere.
Saul walks in to see her looking behind the singing bowls, and he startles Frankie.
Jesus, Saul, why do you keep walking into rooms?
Because I'm ambulatory and curious. What are you looking for?
Solitude.
I'm on to you, Frankie.
What? To what are you referring?
You gave us the room with the twin beds instead of the room with the queen, so that we'd be uncomfortable and leave sooner.
Oh, right. Oh, yes, my little Belgian friend. Yes, my little Belgian friend. You're too clever by half.
But there is more, mademoiselle. I have also deduced that then you felt guilty, so you pushed the beds back together.
That wasn't me.
Oh, I guess Robert did it then.
Saul sits on the swinging chair.
I know that Saul. I know that Saul needs to talk, Cy, and I'm always here for you, but right now I'm up against a ticking clock.
Why?
Because we all are, damn it. Still it.
Okay. So, since my prostate surgery, Robert and I haven't been, intimate.
Now I'm dialed in. How's Robert dealing with it?
Interior kitchen, Robert is there chomping on his spaghetti and meatball sub. Grace watches him impatiently, arms folded, hands still in the cereal box. We're now back in the meditation room. Frankie is raptly attentive to Saul.
It's not Robert, it's me. I feel like I'm being betrayed by my own body. How can I ever trust things will be the same? What if I'm not the same man? I feel like damaged goods.
Oh, you're not damaged goods, Saul. Your goods just took a knock. You know what? Let's get some good energy going in that area. I want to do some. Oh, damn it.
Reiki.
Wait a minute. My line spilled.
Your line spilled?
Your line spilled or your drink did?
Let's get some good energy going in that area. I could do some Reiki healing.
I'll take my pants off.
Don't make this weird, Saul.
We're in the beach house kitchen and family room. Grace, carrying her cornflakes box, is about to go up the stairs, but she sees Bud and Coyote coming through the front door carrying two of Robert and Saul's chairs.
No. What are you doing?
This is Dad and Dad's stuff. They told us to bring it over.
And there's a bunch more in the U-Haul, so where do you want these?
Back at Saul and Robert's. Barring that, I don't give a shit.
Grace starts up the stairs.
Is it just me, or is she being friendlier than usual?
A solid, I tolerate you two vibe.
Yes, found it!
Grace stops dead in her tracks and heads back into the kitchen.
Frankie, when you're secretly trying to find illicit cash, you don't yell out, found it! What is that?
My Reiki pendulum for dowsing.
Does it find money?
No, but you found John.
I'm holding a box of cornflakes. Why is this John? Don't tell me.
Sitting on a cornflake, waiting for the van to come.
Great. Well, the van is going to come and take us to prison if we don't find the rest of the cash and get it out of here by tomorrow morning.
I'm all over that. But first, I need to do Reiki on Saul's hookah.
What?
I need to do Reiki on Saul's hookah.
Hoo-ha!
On the QT, since the operation, he and Robert are having some problems downstairs. You know what I mean.
You use the word hoo-ha. How could I not know what you mean? Sit on.
That H looks like a K. Hookah. Actually, you didn't use that word. No, as an internet certified Reiki healer, it's my duty to help him. And we flooded his home.
Yeah, I know. I feel bad about that too, but I need their sorry asses out of here because I'm looking for money and all I keep finding is them.
All right, we're going to take a little break right now. I wanted to tell you a couple things. Please stick around for the Q&A, which is going to follow the end of our table read. If you have any questions, just type them into the comments section and we'll get to as many as we can. And I want to remind you, please try to give whatever you can. They need our help more than ever, and the costs and the efforts associated with protecting seniors from COVID-19 requires additional emergency funds. Please just give what you can.
And Marta, after we're finished, we're gonna reveal who's wearing pants and who's not wearing pants, right?
That is correct.
Okay, good.
That is correct.
You weren't going to tell.
Tomlin.
What?
You're the camera is at the top of your screen.
Yeah.
So to the extent that you can, when you're reading your script, try to look at
and I have to scroll my script up, and that's when I get screwed up. It jumps to another page.
Oh.
What happens to yours? Okay, let's say I'm reading this first page right along. It's really good, and I'm like going up and up and
up. That's good now. The way you're looking right now is good.
Okay, I understand, but I see the lights in my glasses. That's not good.
Hey, Lily, what room in your house are you in?
The office.
Jane, where are you?
Very small. I'm in my basement.
My office is small? No, it's very big. You can't see it. I have a screen up to hide the litter.
I just learned that because of everything wonderful that's happening with all the people watching this show, the Meals on Wheels site has crashed.
Can we be celebrating that?
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please keep trying. Please keep trying.
Wow.
Way to go, people.
Yeah, and also, let's remind everybody, this sort of reading is going to be up on the Netflix is a joke website, and you can
YouTube channel, you can also
give later to Meals on Wheels, but if you can't get through because it's crashed,
it's a shame. It'll be permanent.
Trying to steal the scene by having a goat eating her sign.
It's not a goat.
It's a sheep.
Marta and Howard, there's no way that based on our performance in this live read, we would be recast from season 2.
I'm not going to comment on that.
But look, there's still time because we have more of the script to do. So, if everybody wants to pick up their performance.
There's even time for plastic surgery.
Oh, perfect.
All right, you guys want to get moving?
Yeah.
Do it.
Section,
so to speak.
All right, here we go. Exterior beach house courtyard. Mallory and Brianna are staring at something, confused.
Oh my God, wait a minute.
Scene 15, Lily.
What page is that? 17.
22.
17.
17.
Whoops.
Oh my God. Okay.
You don't have a page 17?
Hey, Lily, it's not your scene.
It's okay. You don't have to say it.
I've got to follow along.
Scene 15.
Okay, I've got it.
All right. So Mallory and Brianna are staring at something, confused.
Text about Nick didn't surprise me. This throws me off.
We reveal a passed out Robert on a lounge chair with a plate of sandwich crumbs sitting on his chest. Bud and Coyote, heading back to the stairs, walk past Mal and Brianna.
Hey, what's going on with my dad? Was he really upset about Nick?
Why would he be upset about Nick?
Isn't Nick why you're here?
Did Nick cause the flood?
There was a flood?
Why do you think our parents are all living together?
Our parents are all living together?
Back in the beach house family room, Grace is heading out of the kitchen to the stairs with her cornflakes box when Brianna and Mallory enter.
Oh, fuck.
She turns away and heads up the stairs.
Mom, where are you going?
She keeps going up the stairs.
We know you saw us.
They follow her up. We're in Grace's bedroom. Moments later, Mallory and Brianna enter the bedroom to see Grace putting the box of cornflakes into her safe. She quickly closes it.
Girls, what a lovely surprise. Why are you here?
Why didn't you just put cornflakes in the safe?
To lock in the freshness.
Mom,
that's sad.
Nick bombshell, so you might be in shock.
Certainly that he was caught.
I can't talk about that now. Anything but Nick.
What's with Robert and Saul and the flood?
Anything but Nick and Robert and the flood and Saul.
I had this really interesting dream last night.
All right. Okay, well, thanks for stopping by. We'll be in touch.
Get out ahead for the door.
Where are you going? We are not abandoning our mother right now.
How about in 5 or so?
Cornflakes in the safe. You're not going anywhere.
Oh, I'm sorry. Are you my supervisor of leaving rooms too?
Brianna walks out of the room. Mallory is embarrassed and Grace looks at her.
I know. Our new dynamic is a little rocky, but I am taking Brianna out tonight for a real heart to heart. Tanith gave me this gift certificate from that new restaurant, Juliana's. It's like crazy fancy. And
give it to me. Robert and Saul need it more than you and Brianna, and I need it more than all of you.
Grace takes Mallory's bag and starts rifling through it.
That may be true, but isn't that a judgment call to be made by the owner of the gift certificate?
Grace finds it and gives Mallory back her bag, keeping the gift certificate.
Mom, that was my plan for dealing with Brianna.
It wasn't a great plan. But you don't need me. You got this.
How do you know?
Oh, because you took the job. And you knew the shit show you'd be facing with Brianna by taking it, but you did it anyway. Because being the boss is in you.
You really think so?
I know so. Now I need you and Brianna to get the fuck out of here. Go on.
We're in the beach house meditation room, Frankie making odd guttural sounds as deep into her Reiki healing of Saul's groin. But Saul is tense because Brianna is now there and talking to Frankie.
Which is why I'm at a complete loss here, and I really need your take on this Mallory shit.
Frankie makes more noise.
Make some noises, Frankie. I just had to hear it again. Brianna, this is kind of a private Reiki session.
Relax, Saul.
I'm trying.
It's you, Frankie.
I can't. I've lost my place. We're doing some groin work on your father.
If you wanted to solve your problem.
Oh, wait, where is it?
Hey, 701, scene 18.
I've got seven.
Page 21.
It's up.
Wait a second. Oh, okay, 21.
At the top.
Oh, this is so embarrassing. Wait a second. Oh, at the top, did you see? Oh, here, I got to try again. Here we go. Right in the most crucial moment of the script.
It's okay. We can get it back. We can get it back.
We can do it.
Nothing's wrong.
At the top of the scene. Interior beach house meditation room. Frankie's making out guttural sounds.
What is the page?
20.
20. It's the page before. But you don't have anything to say. So just chill. Just make
see, if my thing, if you go too fast, the type gets all garbled up.
Yeah.
All right.
So just make Reiki noises.
Scene 18.
All right. Yeah, keep it up.
Go, June.
Which is why I'm at a complete loss here, and I really need your take on this Mallory shit.
More Reiki noises. Brianna, this is kind of a private Reiki session.
Relax, Saul.
I'm trying.
Oh, boy.
Now it's your turn.
I'm just way off base.
That's okay.
It's hard mastering a computer and acting at the same time.
Very hard.
I think we're all feeling that.
I'm one of the few people who have done it.
Did you find the place yet, Lily?
Well, where are we? Am I supposed to be 22?
21.
No, 21.
21. Well, I said we're doing some groin work on your father. Is that not right?
No, you're too far ahead. We're on scene 18.
Okay, 18. And then Frankie says, if you want to solve your problem, you need to think like Mallory. But right now, I need you to think like me. I'm stoned and listening to the Beatles. Where would I hide something?
The linen closet.
Brilliant. I got to go. Brianna, take over the Reiki.
Oh, God, no.
Hard pass.
I'll take over the Reiki. What's our focus?
We're doing some groin work on your father.
Great.
Not great.
We're in the beach house stairs. Grace carrying a gift certificate and Mallory both come down the stairs.
You keep her off guard like this. Hey, Brianna, Mallory's leaving without you.
Like hell she is.
Mallory bolts for the front door with Brianna fast on her heels. As they exit, Frankie meets Grace at the bottom of the stairs.
To the linen closet.
Already left. Already checked. Nothing there.
What is that?
Our way to get them out to dinner so we can search the house.
But what are we going to have for dinner? That's on the table, right?
Interior beach house living room. Robert and Saul are sitting on the couch, feet up on the coffee table, watching a Western on TV. Grace and Frankie enter and stand facing the two men, blocking their view.
Three men are about to get shot, and I can't see the TV.
We hear three gunshots. Pew,
pew, pew. There they go.
Grace turns off the TV and faces the men.
We feel bad about a couple of things.
First and foremost, that our toilet exploded. That must have sucked.
And we haven't exactly been welcoming.
We feel less bad about that, but still bad, but less bad.
To make it up to you, we got you a gift certificate to Juliana's for tonight.
Grace hands a Mallory's gift certificate.
Grace hands a Mallory's gift certificate. Oh, yay, your favorite place.
Never heard of it.
Your new favorite place.
I'm not hungry. You saw what I ate.
You said you'd rally.
That was very thoughtful of you. We'll just use it another night.
Nope, nope. You have to go tonight.
Already booked a table for tonight.
Well, then why don't you two go?
No, Frankie and I don't need a romantic night out. You and Robert do.
Why do we need a romantic night?
Why? Well, because it's a thing people do now when their houses flood. Jeez, Robert, pick up a New York Times once in a while.
Robert turns to Saul, who looks incredibly guilty.
You told them.
No, I told Frankie.
Then I told Grace.
Right, of course. 5 minutes after we move in and you're back talking to Frankie when you should be talking to me.
Robert, this isn't like those other times I went to Frankie.
It sure feels like it.
You know where a good place to hash this out would be? Juliana's.
Why don't you go and take Saul with you?
Robert storms out of the patio. Saul and Carl follow him outside.
Lock the door, Frankie. Quick.
Frankie locks the door and peers out. The men are arguing, but we can't hear what they're saying. As Robert gesticulates wildly, he bumps the kayak that is hanging on the fence and a stack of money falls out of it. Luckily, the men are yelling at each other so they don't notice it hit the ground.
That's where Ringo is.
Grace looks out the back doors.
In the kayak? Like Yellow Submarine.
Oh, that would have been good too.
The women peer out to see Carl walk over to the pile of money and start sniffing. He then pees on the cash.
Oh, come on.
I know for a fact you can still use bills after you've peed on them.
Never, ever tell me how you know that.
In my defense, Andrew Jackson had it coming.
We're going to get that wet wad before they see it.
Well, I won't be using the zip line you made me return.
We're on the beach house patio. Robert and Saul are still arguing.
All these years, you've been on me about talking more and actively listening, and I've been trying, but it feels like you don't trust that I'll be there for you.
It's not about trust.
Then why the hell would you talk to Frankie and not me?
It was easier to talk to Frankie because it didn't involve her.
Grace and Frankie come out onto the patio. Frankie is holding a weird-looking, multicolored sweater.
Hey-ho, sorry to disturb.
How about instead of being sorry, you just don't disturb?
Grace surreptitiously makes her way to the money and stands in front of the cash, pushing it behind her with her feet.
Frankie, we're in the middle of something.
Yes, I want to get you to the end of that something.
She holds up a giant sweater. It's big enough for two people to get into simultaneously, and it has four sleeves.
The conflict resolution sweater?
Arms up, everybody.
Frankie, I'm not in the mood for your magical sweater nonsense.
There's nothing magical about this sweater. It is science.
She forces them close together and deftly gets all four of their arms into the sweater. As she pulls it over their heads, Frankie mouths to Grace, now. And Grace quickly grabs a towel draped over a chair and uses it to gingerly pick up the damp cash. Robert and Saul's heads emerge from the sweater.
I don't see the purpose of this, and I'm leaving.
He tries to storm off, but Saul gets yanked with him.
Oh, that's the purpose. You can't storm off, so you have to deal with each other.
Fine. Saul, will you please storm off with me so we can have some privacy?
Of course.
Easier said than done. The two men clumsily attempt to make their way into the house, still imprisoned by the sweater. So we're going to take another break.
Hey,
so we just heard that the response was has been so amazing that we've crashed the Meals on Wheels website. So I just remind you, A, keep on trying, and B, this video will be up for a while on Netflix is a Joke YouTube channel, and you can always, at any point, donate.
Yes, please.
Yeah, okay.
This is a vital lifeline to millions of homebound seniors who we were already serving, and now millions more who are at risk because of the virus. So thank you for your support. And don't forget to stick around for the Q&A with the cast following the table read.
So many vulnerable citizens would literally starve to death if it weren't for this organization, Meals on Wheels.
Yes.
I personally don't know what I'd do without Instacart.
That's not Meals on Wheels.
Please, nobody make donations to Instacart, because this will have been a failure.
Oh no, that's my fault. Oh God, it's terrible what I
Hey everybody, don't forget to send in comments and put questions in the comment sections for the Q&A, okay?
No, Meals on Wheels, they give the food to the people. Instacart, yes. You've got to pay.
Absolutely.
I don't think it infringes on Meals on Wheels at all.
Uh-oh, I just got a text that the Instacart website has just gone down.
You are so evil. That's not true.
Is that you behind you?
What?
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
What? As if you didn't know.
Is she sitting in a golf cart?
Her very boring mugshot background, and she's actually looks extremely chic.
Thank you very much, Jane. And this wallpaper is available. I'm selling it for.
This is the website.
Yeah. You get donations, you get a free headshot.
Is there
fine?
How you doing, Ethan?
I'm good, Jane. I'm good.
Ethan, where are you in your house? Where are you?
In my music room.
Ethan, no. Is way more serious than we are.
Look at that noise.
It makes me ashamed.
We didn't know you were so into music.
It's therapeutic, you know? It's been very useful to...
Well, you need that.
A couple hours during all of this. It's,
yeah. What have you all been doing to get you through this?
You don't want to know.
I don't want to know.
I'm feeling it has to do with yams.
I do have a question about the set. So, and Baron brought up yams, so I feel like it's the perfect segue. There is a lot of yam lube on set, like jars of it, you know, props are on the set. Is it actual lubrication or is it yam jelly in the jars? Because it is full, like the jars have a substance inside. Do we know what's in the jars on set? They're everywhere.
Oh, it's yam lube.
It is.
Okay, second question. How long have you been wanting to ask this question, Brooklyn? How many jars of that lube did you steal?
I have not stolen a single jar, but now I might. Now that
knowing Emily is our prop master, mistress, and she's very method, so I can assure you it's real lamb lube, yam lube, yams and lubricant, and not palm oil.
No palm oil in it. No.
You can also get that on this site.
I've eaten it and it's kind of nice.
All right, we're going to jump back in. We're going to jump back into the last act. You ready?
All right.
Okay.
Lily, it's scene 21.
I'm right there.
All right,
good. Yeah.
Don't yell.
All right. We're interior, say Grace, Brianna's office. Brianna walks into her office, but is shocked to see Mallory sitting behind her desk in Brianna's chair. Adam is standing by Mallory and waiting as she signs papers like a pro and hands them back to him.
I can see you crawling this.
Thank you, and I will be right back with your toasted muffin post-haste.
As Adam heads out.
I'll also have my muffin toasted and at a temperature I find agreeable.
Brianna approaches her desk.
Excuse me.
Yes?
You don't seem to know where your desk is. It's not a promising sign for a supervisor.
You know what, Brianna? Let's just drop the bullshit. Mm. The truth is, I'm not your supervisor.
Exactly. Thank you, Mallory.
I'm really your boss. Now, shoo! I have work to do.
Oh, Mallory dismisses with her hand, pointing the way to the conference table, just like Brianna did to her in the morning. Completely thrown, Brianna walks to the conference table in a fugue state and sits down. Adam re-enters with two plates. He gives Mallory her beautifully presented, toasted and buttered, regular-sized muffin, and he then puts Brianna's muffin down in front of her. It's a mini muffin, cold, still in the paper.
You think this is my first game of big muffin, small muffin? I invented big muffin, small muffin.
We're in the beach house dining room. Grace and Frankie are sitting at the table.
All we need to do is find George and we're home free. Didn't he write, "While my guitar gently weeps"? Let's see, what weeps besides me if we don't find the money?
The song is actually called, "While My Guitar Gently Sleeps."
No, it isn't. Guitars don't sleep.
Sure they do. That's why you put them away in their little beds. That's why I put it in the bedroom with the queen bed, because he's British.
Only words I heard are queen bed, so that's where I'm gonna look.
Grace rushes upstairs.
Or is it, "Why My Guitar Gently Sweeps"?
Frankie heads towards the hall closet by the side door. Interior beach house, upstairs hallway. Grace walks down the hallway, passing one room with a closed door. This is Robert and Saul's room. Grace rolls her eyes as she passes. Goes to the other door, opens it, and steps right in. She stops dead in her tracks, horrified by what she sees happening in the bed.
Oh, God.
Look away!
Interior beach house hall closet. Frankie finds the George wad of cash behind the broom and shouts with glee.
Yes! No!
Still on Grace, we hear.
Up here!
Grace retreats, aghast, slamming the door behind her. Her eyes will never unsee what she just saw. Interior beach house dining room the next day. Welcome to the most awkward breakfast ever. Grace can't look at Robert or Saul, and they can't look at her or each other. The three of them are silent and barely eating. The only one unaffected is Frankie, who happily gobbles up her food after a beat.
So the conflict resolution sweater worked. You got to feel good about that. You are going to dry clean that for us, aren't you?
I'm going to throw it away.
Okay, fine. I'm going to finish my breakfast somewhere else.
Robert takes his plate and heads into the library.
I can't eat.
Saul takes his dishes into the kitchen, leaving Grace and Frankie alone at the table. The ring phone intercom buzzes.
And I thought Rushmore liked to sleep in. The money is still in the safe.
It's the FBI. At the door, they're early.
What? Did I miss all?
But the money isn't in the safe. I got it out of the house.
Oh, that's right.
Let's go back to oh God, it's the FBI.
Sure.
James, oh my, the FBI.
They're early.
And I thought Rushmore liked to sleep in. The money is still in the safe.
No, it isn't. I got it out of the house.
How? You never even left.
We're interior Robert and Saul's living room. A miserable coyote and Bud are now lugging Robert and Saul's two chairs back into the house.
I'm glad we took these all the way all the way to the beach just to bring them all the way back.
Why are we always the guys schlepping things? Why aren't Mallory and Brianna here?
Because they have jobs.
So do we.
What? No.
Yes.
Oh, shit.
He drops his chair and runs out. Bud puts down his as well. Angle on the underside of the chairs where the cash is taped. We're in the beach house dining room.
Genius.
The intercom buzzes again. We're in the beach house library and Robert is trying to balance his plate on his lap, but it's tenuous to best. He looks around and decides to move the chess pieces and use that chessboard as a tray. When he picks up the chessboard, he feels something underneath. He lifts it higher to look, and the chessboard has a wad of cash taped to the bottom of it.
What the? Grace, Frankie, what the hell is this?
Grace and Frankie rush in to see Robert fuming and holding up the bills.
What the hell, Frankie? There are only four Beatles.
Oh, God, I forgot about Pete Best.
Saul enters.
The FBI is on the way down.
Oh, shit.
What are you cursing about? I'm the one holding the dough. How are we going to explain this?
We're not. And before you go running your mouth off to the feds, you should know that the rest of the cash is now hidden in your house.
What? That's right, Saul. You're in this up to your eyeballs. And you're the tallest one here. So do that math.
You hear the FBI agents knocking at the door.
And what you're gonna do is shove that money down your pants and zip up your mouth.
And your pants too, please.
Frank, please, I understand you're upset, but listen to yourself. Do you realize what you're saying? What you're asking?
I'm not asking. I'm telling. I'm done being humiliated by husbands who are constantly doing whatever the hell they want without any regard to how it affects me. So now I'm doing the doing.
But you're not doing anything. You're making him do it.
Without any regard for how it affects me.
Well, boo fucking who? I've already had one husband in jail, and now I'm not going to get all weepy if I have an ex there, too.
They're monsters.
We hear louder knocking on Robert's panicked look. We fade out. End of episode.
Yeah.
How did
Thank
we
you.
Do?
Shooting Thank you for an amazing table read.
And Thank also, you. You're welcome.
I just want to say one thing. You know, you probably saw me laughing a lot, and it's this show is my sense of humor. I enjoy it, but I want to say it's the work of all of our writers. And we have a great group of writers, and we've actually been meeting on Zoom every day, and we're still writing the episodes and looking forward to getting them out to everybody. Because it's an amazing group and we just don't want to stop, so we're not.
That's good to hear. Really
so
good.
we will have more episodes.
Yes, we will. So there are questions that have been coming in all evening, the whole time we've been doing this, that I'd love to throw out at a bunch at all of you. And one of the questions is, Martin, someone asked, what's your favorite song to sing on set? Besides anything.
Did Martin ask this question?
This is a plant.
Would you sing the song for us, Martin? Would you?
I can't remember. I love to sing and carry on like make a fool of myself, which I'm being asked to do right now, and I'll be glad to oblige, but I can't remember the song. Do you know which one you're referring to?
You sing so much on set, it could be anything.
I guess
somebody help me here, please.
So I have to ask you now, this is from at Oat Milk Lattes, who wanted to know, what is the thing you miss most about being on set right now?
Are you asking me?
Everybody.
But for me, it's this very community. It's this spirit that I miss. Very much so.
It's all these people in the flesh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. In the same space. It's
and seeing the crew.
So much fun.
I miss
so much fun.
The tree guy. I miss the plant people. Close to nature. You all are just frivolous Hollywood types.
That's our tree guy.
So a woman named Millie would like to know who is most like their character. All right, next question.
Oh, wait, we're not going to answer the question.
Nobody's going there.
I'll answer for everyone. Yeah.
Colleen Lynn wanted to know, and this is for Jane and Lily, I believe, how many vibrators are too many?
I have four at the moment, and that's...
Wow.
Really? Well, you're the vibrator expert. I think I should defer to you in this question.
I think four is a good number. I got three for Christmas this year.
From whom? Who gave them to you?
I don't know. People. I don't know. And I haven't tried any of them.
Maybe they were from fans.
I mean, it sounds like Brooklyn is stockpiling lubricant.
She's trying to.
You just spare any Christmas gifts. You know, we're in quarantine.
I'll send one your way,
Mama Jane.
So let me say, besides the vibrators and the lubricant, Georgia Thomas XO wants to know, what are your tips for getting through this?
Be nice to people.
Be nice to the guy at Jerry's, because they deliver quickly, and Jerry's Deli, you know, maybe there's another deli in your neighborhood, but the ones who deliver quickly, like in a couple of hours, of course, you have to lay a big tip on them, which is good. My God, I can't even bear for the people to bring stuff to me. I'm so worried about them not being properly clothed or protected or whatever. But anyway, that's just a stupid kind of person who doesn't have to work anymore for hard-earned money. So I'm kind of embarrassed that I even answered it. So forgive me.
I think activism. I think staying involved with something that you know is really, really important. It makes you feel good, and you try to get other people involved. And that's what Fire Drill Fridays keeps me from getting bored or anything during this difficult time.
Celeste Chris wants to know, what are you doing to keep your sanity during the quarantine? Anything special?
I've learned to cook. I cook all the meals in our house, or prepare them, or plan ahead for them. Because of today's table read, I'm not sure what there will be for supper.
How's that going, Lily?
And that's a real chore. When I think of the women who've been doing the cooking, raising the children, maybe they even have a job. It's just, I can't even tolerate what it means they've endured. Because to do the cooking is sort of fun and great experience. And I've learned all kinds of incredible things, like how to equate tablespoons with a quarter cup of sour cream and stuff like that. You just look it up on the internet. Now, there was a day when my mother was a housewife. She didn't have the luxury of the internet to answer those really hard put questions. So anyway, I'm going to drop out of show business as soon as we wrap up. Thank you. I am. Because I see how much stuff I've missed.
What was the question, Marta?
One of the questions that came up was, has playing the characters on Grace and Frankie taught you any life lessons?
Don't put my video up there.
Say what you got to say to people.
Why are they picking me out to answer that question? Have it taught me any life lessons?
Well, no, this is a general question.
All I do is I've learned life lessons from Fonda. That's all she distributes is life lessons.
I've learned life lessons from you.
Oh, you've been misguided in that respect.
She always finds the funny. She always finds the positive. That's important for someone like me who comes from a long line of really depressed people.
Oh, God.
I want to say,
I'm sorry, Cora, go ahead.
I love seeing Hannah on the earlier videos when we were like rehearsing Hard to Believe, but we kind of rehearsed our technical.
Don't tell them.
That's my own inability.
Cora, what are you gonna
Hannah
say?
Had her little boy, and what is he, 11 months? And he was off, he's like it's like he's 15 or something. And he got off her lap and I could see him in the background walking into the kitchen.
That's my grandson.
Yeah.
Cora, what were you going to say?
Well, I just wanted to say, like, being new to this group in this last season, I mean, one thing that I was just, that took my breath away was how truly lovely and wonderful and welcoming everyone was. Like, even just waiting, you know, before takes, no one was, had their heads in their phones, which would have been understandable. Like, I felt welcomed and there was community and conversation and deep welcoming spirit. And I felt like that's something that I hope I will see again on other sets. And it was really breathtaking. And I think that's really rare. And so I just want to say that something I would.
Cora, I think it's lovely remark. Wait a second, Brianna, I'm older. The reason that we don't have phones is because we don't know how to operate them. We're
what did you say?
We don't know how to operate
them. Made her point, actually.
We don't know how to operate them.
Very true.
Except those, the younger ones, our kids, but they're rarely on the set.
And I know, Cora,
Cora.
I told you, Cora, not to make eye contact with me.
I know. I know it's been difficult. I've been trying not to, but you know, I just keep on looking at the green light.
Yeah, but I appreciate you. That's,
I've gotten your chat messages, and I'll stop.
So we've gotten a number of questions from people asking if you could play a different character on the show, who would it be?
I play Betty Davis.
Not sure that she's a part of the show.
Guest.
You know, I would want to take a stab at Joan Margaret.
Great answer.
Played by Millicent Martin generally, except for when June wants to do it. anybody else?
Well, I want you to know Millicent likes me more than she likes anybody else in the cast.
I don't agree with you, but I'll accept that. She spends more time with you.
She likes me a lot.
She does like you. She writes me about you in her emails, and that sort of boils me. But I can overlook it because you bring her groceries.
She never talks about either of you when she writes to me.
What are some more questions?
You know, I think we've reached
the end of our rope.
There are 1,000 more questions, but we can't get to them all. I think this has been amazing. And everyone, thank you so much. I also want to say, before we sign off, we want to thank you. We want to send a special thanks to Netflix and to Skydance for being so supportive of doing this. And a big shout out to all of you, incredible cast. And to take a moment, I don't know how many fans are watching right now, but I just want to take a moment and say that so many of us are all connected right now in this one moment. And as isolated as we feel, this is a chance for us all to be together. So thank you for being here. I love you all.
And I want to thank Governor Newsom for running a good state. Bless his heart.
Yeah,
he's a real leader on the corona virus.
Yes, he is. Yeah. And don't forget, the website may be having a hard time, but come back.
Yes. And this wallpaper is available for purchase. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you all.
Bye, guys.
Thank you, everybody.
Good night. Good night, everybody. Thank you.